So in this particular combination, I'm going to be specifically looking to see how these guys have combined wild cards and pick 10 together to complement each other's play styles, because with this multi-team deathmatch game, this action's so intense and these guys are going to have to be cooperating. So I want to see how different their classes are and how similar they are, and that should be a really interesting thing to look for here.
Stuff. Okay, so the guys are into their teams now. The guys that they're playing with are the guys they play with all the time, so the communication should come to the fore here. Tell us about the map that we're playing on, Hastro.
Sure, so we're actually going to be launching this game on Turbine, and it's going to be multi-team, like David said. So it's 3 versus 3 versus 3 versus 3, 4 teams of 3. And the map Turbine is just going to be an excellent choice here in this multi-team TDM. It just plays really fast. It's a great map. You can climb on everything. And it's going to be great.
All right, multi-team team deathmatch, twice the teams, twice the carnage. Look out for that communication teamwork coming to the fore. Let's get going with it.
All right, here we go. We're going, boys.
All right, folks.
Good luck.
So, this is David Vonderhaar in the booth with me, and we're about to launch Turbine multi-team team deathmatch. And this is quite the interesting game mode, Vaughn. What are your predictions right here? And go ahead and make a prediction.
I'm going to predict that this thing is going to be wire to wire, that these guys are really going to just get super into this thing, and we're going to see some tough, tight, close scores the entire match.
Yeah, I actually agree. Multi-team TDM is introducing, you know, so many different aspects into the gameplay just because of the fact that you're adding multiple teams, as we see Gunshy, who finished that last game absolutely on fire, picking up another kill right there, and that was on Nice, and that was actually Nice from the team control. Germany. And why don't we pull the picture-in-picture up and take a look here, Vaughn. We see that Optic is actually playing as the Seals faction that I'm hovered over with my cursor right here. And then now we see that Team Prophecy from the UK is playing as the SDC faction. Now Team Envious from North America is playing as the FBI faction. And Team Germany is playing as the Mercs faction.
I really like this view because you can tell where every single team is in position right there with Envious up there in first place.
Yep, absolutely. So Envious has taken the early lead, but it's oh so close. 5 kills on the board for Envious. We'll swap on board with Karma and see if he can add to that lead. He's using the M8A1 assault rifle with the target finder. Again, pulling off some nice shots there. He's actually got a select fire attachment as well, so he doubled up on his attachments, Vaughn. Why don't you tell me a little bit about that?
You know, I really like this particular attachment, a select fire switch. You can change between auto and burst modes, and one way that I really like to use it is at long range, I'll actually burst, and at short range, I'll go to auto.
Yep, absolutely. It makes complete sense. I got a little bit of time with it as well, as we see Karma go down for the drop shot. Almost got a double kill with it, but there he is. He's calling in the UAV. And we just saw he picked up the assist on that kill. Now, assist add to the score streaks here in Black Ops 2 multiplayer. What was kind of the decision behind that?
So there's certain score streaks that you really want to be able to reward players for using and activating, and those are particularly the ones like this one, because these are not actually generating kills for you. But if that thing's up, you're seeing that assist points for using any kind of support-based score streak.
Got it. So the UAV will actually give you some points towards your next score streak.
That's exactly right.
As we see
right.
Karma picking up another kill right there and spots another one. Looks like he had a foot in the way right there as he went prone. And let's take a look at the overhead map and see where Karma is spawning back in. Looks like he's going to run into a player right here.
No.
And he did. It was Nice from the Team Germany. But Envious still has the lead at the moment. They have 18 kills on the board, starting to create some separation. 18 to 13. The SDC is in second, and that is Team Prophecy. And Twiz now for Envious is on a 3-kill streak. Why don't we take a look at his loadout? He's rocking the M8A1 as well. Seems like he has, is that a bouncing Betty there and a smoke grenade maybe? Or is that maybe a flash grenade? Looks like a flash grenade. So looks like Twiz is kind of going with that classic reflex.
Interesting fight to see him burst at this range, actually. I would think that you'd want to get in there. Those guys are such precision shooters, though. Man, this is such a great player, Twiz.
Yep. Twiz is definitely solid, and now Envious has taken the lead even more. Why don't we actually take a listen in to Team Envy, Vaughn, and see how well they're communicating.
Yeah, he's next to us.
Yeah, he's right to your left.
Got him.
Another one down low. Down low terror building. Let's work for a kill streak.
Nah, it's not.
Big kill.
I've got your AV, but I'm weak.
Throw it up. And you'll work for a counter. There's one, another one, top turret over here.
Next week.
All right, Vaughn, so Envious definitely had some great communication right there. 2 minutes left to go. That is probably why they have such a good lead. You know, the communication is oh so crucial, and in CODcasting mode, we can actually put you into the game with the players with one touch of a button, which is one of my favorite features, if not my favorite in CODcasting mode. And it looks like Twiz just missed a player who came up behind him, and it was Optic Ray. And let's see how Optic is doing at the moment. They are your FBI's team, and it looks like they are kind of slacking behind. They're down by about 7 kills. Not to see is now coming back. Vaughn, Shane has a 6-kill streak. Why don't we take a look at him?
Absolutely. One of the best ways to figure out what player is really hot right now, pulling up picture in picture, seeing that kill streak column and knowing exactly where he does.
Absolutely.
Oh, maybe did we just curse him right there?
Well, that happens to me all the time when I swap the players. I curse him, and look at this. Shane is fully loaded with score streaks right now.
He's got the death machine out. This should be really entertaining.
Yeah, the death machine is just massive in this game. It does some super damage to the body of enemy soldiers, but you know what I like to use it for? I actually like to take out score streaks with it, because it's brutal. I mean, if there's a score streak in the sky and I can take it out with the death machine, I'm going to do it. It really fires so many bullets, and it's kind of absolutely devastating, those score streaks, and it's absolutely devastating right there as we see Shane picking up the kill on Big Timer from Optic. Envious is still in the lead by 4. We're headed into the last minute of the game now, Vaughn, and why don't we take a look at the picture-in-picture again? And let's see if we can hop on board with somebody who's on fire. Looks like Gunchy's on the 3-kill streak. Now, why don't you tell me a little bit about Gunchy's class,
what
you can see.
Yeah, so Gunchy, once again, this select fire seems to be a very popular attachment with these pro players. And he's got the red dot sight there, and he's going to aim up and put some targets down. He's been playing pretty good all night. All the players have been doing a great job.
Yeah, and it looks like there are 19 seconds left to go. And there's a care package there for Gunchy. He's only down by 3 kills. He has a care package and a UAV. Choosing not to go ahead and call it in, his strategy might be to go ahead and try and just work around with his gunplay. 6 seconds left, only 2 kills separating our teams. Can they do it as we're on board with Gunchy? Can he catch back up?
Oh,
so close.
Yeah, 42, 41.
He picks
what a
one
great
up
game
right there. And it looks like that was so close to the end. Gunchy picked up that final kill, but it just wasn't enough. If one of his teammates was able to help out, they would have came back and tied it, but Envious is going to take this one. And let's take a look at the scoreboard here as we see Twiz going huge for Team Envious, 19-12.
All right, guys.
Karma with 13 kills on the board. He's negative, though, with 14 deaths. And Toby plus one at 10-9 for Team Envious as they take this one home, Vaughn.
And that was a lot of fun. Those guys are such great players, and we're so honored that they came all the way out to Germany to join us and to, you know, debut this game mode with us. And it's just so much fun watching them.
Yeah,
incredible
awesome
finish there. Prophecy pushing hard to the end of the game there, but Envious just coming out on top. It couldn't have been any closer, right?
Oh, man, and this is what it's all about right now, just watching these guys compete back and forth, watching them trade kills and looking at those tight scores.
Astro, pick out some of the key moments of that game for us.
Oh, man, you know, I would probably say some of the Europeans went on a big kill streaks. They had big kill streaks. One came out of Gunchy, and it looked like Shane had one as well. Swanee actually got in there too, and that actually brought Prophecy back towards Envious's lead, but it was so close there at the very end. That was probably the best moment where I thought Prophecy might actually tie it up. Gunchy got that kill the last split second, just couldn't get another one as Team Envious took it.
That's exactly the kind of competition we're looking for here tonight. Tell us about some of the new weapons and attachments we saw making the big scores in that game.
Yeah, what I learned really, really fast right there is that these pro players love that select fire switch, so they can change between that auto and that burst. But we actually saw the target finder in play really early on in that game, and that attachment allows you to see enemies from a distance. They get targeted up for you. That's our 2025 technology in play in this game.
Great to see that future technology in play. All right, we're going to go straight back in with another multi-team team deathmatch. We're switching maps, though. Tell us about this new map.
Yeah, it looks like we're actually missing our screen for a second here, but when we pull it back up, I think we're about to head into Aftermath.
I believe we're going to play some Aftermath.
Yep, that's absolutely right. So Aftermath actually takes place in Los Angeles. It's kind of a busted down Los Angeles.
Yeah.
And it's actually great. It's got a lot of close quarters combat, a lot of tight corridors. This is a really interesting map to watch.
All right, let's get this kicked off again. We'll try and get your screen sorted out. Let's get going.
Multi-TDM.
Wow, David, tell us what we saw in game one there.
So what we were looking at was a multi-team deathmatch game. So the game supports up to 18 players.
That's first.
So you got six teams of those 18. That's the first. And wow, it's really exciting because you can do any kind of combination using six factions and 18 players. In that case, we were looking at a 3-on-3-on-3-on-3. Mm-hmm. And that's really exciting because that's a lot of enemy threat for those teams to deal with. That squad of three had to work well together to be successful playing the game.
Now, we also saw the Pick 10.
Yeah, the Pick 10 is the wild. Pick 10 combined with wild cards is the framework of what makes up the new Create a Class system. Mm-hmm. And those players were equipped up so they can be successful working together.
Now, there's also some nuances and changes that you actually made to each of the classes in terms of attachments and perks. Tell us a little bit about that.
So in Black Ops 2, for you to modify your weapon in any way, shape, or form, you have to actually take an attachment for it. So in our previous game, you could actually sometimes use perks to modify your weapon. And what this does for us is make sure that we have perks be about player and player behavior, mm-hmm, and attachments be about weapon and weapon behavior. And that's a really important part of how we're tuning the game.
Now, that's actually really different from previous games. Why that decision?
So it's really important to us to make that decision because players expect that an attachment would modify the behavior of a gun and not them. So therefore, we could tune how much they modify a gun when they belong to the gun instead of with a player.
So it just makes more sense.
Yeah, so you know, if you have something that modifies, say, the hip-fire accuracy of a weapon, it's much better for us if we can attach that to the gun instead of the player, so it doesn't have to modify the hip-fire accuracy across every category of weapon. We can do it specifically for the gun. That lets us tune the guns even better.
David, Hardpoint's a brand new mode.
Yeah, so Black Ops 2 multiplayer has Hardpoint. Hardpoint is a mode that's inspired by those traditional King of the Hill style play. So you're going to have to defend an area around the map, and you're going to have to keep those attackers out of there, and you have to be in it in order to score points. That zone is moving around the map, lots of intense action going into a single place on the map. Very fun.
Sounds like it's going to be pretty hard to defend.
Yes, but that's what the team tactics are all about in Black Ops 2 multiplayer, and we've given you lots of great ways to set up defensive perimeters with Guardian as a crowd control mechanic and others.
So let's turn our attention to the codcasting feature, because Hastro was really going at it in there.
Yeah, that guy's a professional, and what we did with him is make sure that he and a lot of guys like him have the tools right inside the game to present the game to a viewer in a very exciting way.
So that's actually really important, because you guys are putting these tools in the game, and there's probably another Hastro out there in the audience right now. So everyone gets these tools.
Yeah, I hope we actually find lots of Hastro-like guys, right? And that we can make those guys pretty famous on the internet, becoming color commentators for Black Ops 2.
Really exciting. All right, let's get back to gameplay.
Hey, everybody, welcome back. We're just sorting out a minor technical hitch. We'll get right back to the gameplay as soon as possible. So I'm joined by Hastro and Vaughn in the meantime. And we've been looking through your tweets to the hashtag BlackOps2MP. Keep them coming in. I think we need to treat Treyarch as well, right? And we want to answer your questions. We want to hear what you think about the game, the new features. We've got a few up here. So at iBonkers says, I'm going to use that codcasting so much. Now, and I've been thinking about this, Hastro, right? You've had it pretty easy lately, right? But you're going to get lots of competition with this new codcasting feature.
Hey, you know what? The more the merrier, honestly. I really would love for the community to embrace that feature, codcasting. And you know what? It's actually also great when you can take it into theater mode, right? So you'll be able to, potentially it's in development, but potentially be able to record your gameplays and cast them out after in theater mode. So you'll take your saved gameplays and you can kind of work with the codcasting features, remove the elements of the HUD, customize the way your screen looks whenever you have that gameplay saved.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And not a lot of people know about that right yet. So when you go into the theater, you can actually pull up codcasting from a game that's already been played. So imagine that everybody can practice being a codcaster, and you're going to see a lot of guys who create video on demand of some of these top games that get played. I think it's going to be amazing what happens.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
And Vaughn, when we talked the other night, one of the things that you said that really stood out for me was that you see an opportunity to bring esports to the masses, and you reckon that Black Ops 2 is the game that can do it. You know, how important is it for you to work with that esports community and bring it out so that everyone can get the benefit?
Yeah, we spent a lot of time over the last couple of months and even before that thinking really hard and critically about what does it mean to actually bring this feature to the masses. And it actually takes a lot of things. The first thing that we have to do is we have to make it a sport. To make it a sport, we have the feature called League Play, and that uses skill-based matchmaking, so players can play with people of their skill level. Competition is fun at any level. This is not just for these super hardcore pro players. It's just really good to compete with somebody who's at your skill level. You should win and you should lose equally. More to that, though, we have the podcasting feature that we just talked about. That's how you put the production around that sport, right? You got guys like Castro and many others who will come out and help make this very entertaining and fun to watch. And then we have a way to get that to everyone with our live streaming feature. Those three things combined, along with great personalities like Castro, that's how you get this thing and make it something for everybody.
I think that league play feature is really sticking out for me because, you know, I'm definitely not a pro player, but it gives me the opportunity to play and always be competitive against players my level, right? How important is that, Astro?
It's extremely important. You know, essentially, that's the sport of Call of Duty. You know, we're able to create leagues for players to play in, and they're able to kind of track their progress as a team with their teammates. And, you know, what's more fun than that? And that's essentially what Call of Duty is and traditionally, but now we kind of formalize it with ranking yourself up and trying to be the best you can within the division that you play in, and you're also playing against competition that's around your skill level, so your objective is to kind of get better faster than they can, so it's a lot more fun that way, and I think League Play is just going to be a great feature for everybody out there to play in.
Okay, another tweet we pulled off the stream here is from @WTG_MollyPop, who's really digging the listening in feature on Codcasting, right? And I think that's one of the other new features that, you know, once you experience it and hear it, it's great because you can really get in the huddle with the team and hear what they're talking about. Again, you know, what was the driving force behind that?
Of all the people for you to pull off the stream, we actually know her. Good, very good to see you. So, listen, I think it's really amazing that you can do the listen-in feature. So, this is about being inside the huddle. It gives us a chance when you're podcasting to jump in and listen to how that team is communicating, and it really gives you this sense of understanding how these teams are working together, and you cannot be mistaken. When you listen in, you know, and it's almost always the guys who are working really well, their emotions that they're feeling, that's the team that's usually doing really well, right, Hestro?
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, we took a listen-in right there in that second round with Envious, and, you know, when they're in the lead and you hear their communication and how well they're strategizing together and making sure that they're working as a team. And, it, you know, it's just so much fun to hear the players talking. I mean, ultimately, we're watching them play, so why not be able to hear a little bit about what they're talking about?
Very good. So we are going to... we keep those tweets coming in. You know, the hashtag is BlackOps2 MP. In the meantime, we're going to hand over to Major Nelson.
Thank you, Graham. BlackOps2 MP, that's where you want to send your tweets. I'm here with Mark Lamia. Mark, before we get back to gameplay, I want to talk to you a little about what it's like running the studio. I mean, there's tremendous trade-offs. Give us a little bit of glimpse behind the scenes.
Yeah, you know what? There's, you know, the team is really ambitious. They're always really going for it. And, you know, I think this is an example of that. The team was really inspired by that world of esports. There's a lot of features in this game, a lot of great new features that are really going to empower players. And, you know, you can't do everything always. We have to make sure that what we're doing well. We have a really great community out there in the esports world, you know, so passionate about the game. They're always telling us, giving us feedback. And I think, you know, Black Ops was on a lot of tournaments, and we were hearing a lot of feedback, and it really inspired us. I remember Vaughn coming back and saying, there are things here that we can do to really, really, really help propel this game and really make it a great competitive game, sports, you know, the broadcasting features and the things that we do in the game, and that became a priority for us. It was something that we really rally behind, you know. But it's not just for the experts and the pros. You know, we have things in there like our leagues feature. You know, we dedicated our time to that, and that's for everyone. Leagues are for everyone, and competition is for everyone.
Why don't you explain to us a little bit about the leagues features? A lot of people, it sounds big and scary, and if I'm a casual player, I may run the other way, but it's exactly the opposite.
The opposite. You know what? Leagues are for everyone. If you're a pro player or a great player, you're going to love leagues because it's all about skill-based matchmaking. You're going to be able to match up with the best of the best. But if you're an average player or a beginner player, that's great too, because it is about skill-based matchmaking. We're going to put you in of people of similar skill, and you're going to be able to compete because, like, Call of Duty is fun when you're winning, of course. It's really fun when you almost win, and we want to make sure that that situation is something that we can get to for all players at all levels.
Now, I want to talk to you a little bit about some more things, but we really have to get back to gameplay. So we're going to get over to Graham right now, and he's going to continue with the gameplay, and we're going to see more of these great features. How's that sound?
That sounds fantastic.
Graham, back to you.
Here we are. We are back in the pit, and we're ready to rumble again. Sorry for that delay, everyone. But Vaughn and Hastro are back with me. We're where we're supposed to be, and we're going to get into some hard point now, right? Yeah. Another new game mode.
It looks like some hard point on cargo. Now, hard point is inspired by those traditional King of the Hill style game modes. This is going to be very intense. Very small areas of the map, locations that you have to be in order to score, and you're going to see so much action pushed onto something that's very intense.
So what should we look out for in terms of the way the players are going to play this hardpoint mode?
Right, so essentially what you want to do is get a nice setup around the hardpoint. It's like David said, similar to a King of the Hill game mode. You're going to get points for being in the hardpoint vicinity. So one player can actually hop in there and score that for your team while your teammates kind of wrap around and set up around it and protect that player who's in there. So that's what you're going to see, these players trying to set up around this part of cargo where the hardpoint is located, and that hardpoint is going to rotate around the map, and players are going to have to move their setup to kind of essentially score those points as it moves.
So again, it's all about communication, all about teamwork. It looks like we've got the North Americans playing against the Europeans again. Who's your money on this time, Vaughn?
Listen, I'm in Germany. I'm taking no sides. It could nothing but get me in trouble, but we'll see what happens. These are both really competitive groups.
Spectacular sitting on the fence. Right, let's get right back to the gameplay, all right? Let's go.
Yeah. How long is the wait?
All right, so Vaughn, we're about to kick it off. Hardpoint on cargo.
This map and this mode. It's so intense.
So this is the first time Hardpoint has ever been streamed, and here we go.
Let's do it.
Now, cargo is such a fast-paced map. We actually checked it out, and it looks like Raiden has a sniper rifle.
It's the
DSR-50. Let's definitely stay on board with him right off the bat.
Yeah, absolutely. He's got that ballistic CPU on the back of that thing, and that's going to reduce his sway. I just love the way that thing looks.
Yeah, and he's going to throw a combat axe. YouTube money.
Yes.
So now he's going to go ahead and walk over here and try and get...
Shot
on Merc. Right off the bat,
now look
gave us a nice thing to look at there.
Yeah, so this is really cool. Now, if you look at the score panel at the top of the screen, when guys are in the zone, you'll see exactly how many players are in there. You'll see that little arrow indicating three players in the zone right now for STC, and that thing's going to be moving around. And that's how we're using the score panel to let you know the state of the game mode.
Right, so as we see on Raiden's screen, the hardpoint is in the office here, and as we take a look on the picture-in-picture overhead map, it looks like this is just chaos here in this area, but it looks like the Europeans have actually taken great control. We see on the picture-in-picture that all these players are on the objective. So you have three players right now. There's an icon there, Vaughn, so that actually tells us that you're on the objective in picture-in-picture mode.
That icon is specifically good for indicating how many people are in that zone, so you know who to pay attention to. And it's just one of the many features of picture-in-picture and how we use objectives, that objective column, and indicating the state of the game for players.
Yeah, now Swanee is on a 4-kill streak. We'll swap over to him, and looks like he's calling in a 4-streak right there. It's a lightning strike.
Oh, nice hit. 2-hit lightning strike kill right there.
That's right, so he picked up 2 kills, and now he's on a 6-kill streak, and look at that shot. What a shot that was.
Oh, so dirty.
Taking out Twiz, too. Twiz was scoped in with a sniper rifle, not paying much attention. He just got it from behind. 8 kills in a row now for Swanee, and finally he goes down, and it looks like our North American team has actually taken the lead once again. Let's go ahead and swap over to them. Toby, who's actually filling in for Proofy on Team Envious, and he's actually European, too, playing with the North Americans. He's doing some work right now. He's got an LMG firing from the hip. He seems to like that LMG.
That's awesome. It's a very nice LMG. You know, in Hardpoint, you get 1 point per second your team occupies that zone, Hastro.
Yeah.
So this could turn around at a moment's notice.
Absolutely. The Europeans are on it right now. Now the North Americans. So you see how quickly it can move. The momentum changes hard so fast. Identified. That's what I'm trying to get at here in Hardpoint. And the game is really close still. This is only a 13-point deficit at the moment with 3 minutes and 45 seconds left to go. So plenty of time on the clock. And this is actually a very close game, Vaughn.
This is an absolute beast of an LMG, this LSAT. It's actually probably my favorite LMG. And Toby here is just going to do work nonstop, I think, laying down shell after shell.
Yeah, he's got Scavenger as one of his perks. Why don't we take a look here at the options screen in picture-in-picture mode and CODcasting mode. So I'm able to actually go through here and remove elements of the HUD, change the way the screen looks. So right now I have the perks turned off, so we can't really tell what Toby is using on his class in terms of perks, but immediately I can just turn it on, and here you go.
Yeah,
there are Toby's perks.
Ghost Scavenger and Dead Silence. He's running pretty traditional setup, I think, for Toby, but it's really nice to use this feature to see how players are equipped up.
Yeah, why don't we actually talk about the perks for a second? Ghost, for example. Tell me a little bit about what's going on with the Ghost perk.
Yeah, so in Black Ops 2 multiplayer, there are no perks that modify your weapons. You have to take an attachment to modify a gun. Ghost only modify you. Perks only modify you, the player. In this case, in order to get the benefit of Ghost, you actually have to be out there running and gunning and moving.
Yeah, so Ghost does not, basically you're not able to be seen by a UAV, just like Ghost was in Black Ops, but you have to be moving to get that perk to work.
Right, it's really important for us to try to keep the game, pushing the action, getting players together. People love the fast-paced gameplay, and a lot of the game mechanics have been set up and tuned to reward that kind of play behavior.
Absolutely, and now Toby is still doing work with this thing. Let's take a look at the scoreboard. And he's 11-9 right now with an LMP. That's actually not that bad.
How do you like the design of the new scoreboard?
Oh, I mean, the scoreboard's amazing here. So, you know, as a caster, it's very important to be able to show information to the audience as quickly as possible. And I know all of you at home are actually quite appreciative of this as well. You can see how much time is left in the game. The score, what team is in the lead. You can actually see how many players are on the objective right now for the SEALs team as they all just got taken off and now contested. So, yeah, I mean, it's just very informational. Love the score panel. As a caster, it's very useful.
I was really surprised right there that Toby didn't check that lane before. He saw that contested icon. There was only one spot that player can be. I think maybe he's having a little too much fun right now.
Yeah, he's having too much fun. He's actually probably still getting used to hardpoint. This is so new, first time that these guys have actually kind of gotten their hands on the game mode and been able to play. So let's see here. Looks like we're going to go ahead and cut back to the picture-in-picture. I'm going to go ahead and see what players are playing the objective. Big Timer is on a 3-kill streak, and he's playing the objective right now. His perks are lightweight, toughness, and extreme conditioning. He gets taken out. He got the MP sub.
That was a nice grab right there. He did have a sitting right on that edge, checking all of his lanes in and out of that hard point. Really good play, actually.
Yeah, now he gets taken out again. He spawns back in. Let's see where he is in relation to the hard point. He's going to run into a couple players here, Vaughn, as he moves to the office. He also has a player flanking him from behind, but he makes it into the building just in time, and now he's got a laser sight attachment on it.
Yeah,
and it looks like somebody just made a big play. Let's see if we can find them. Let's pick out Quiz at the moment.
Really big play right here for the combined U.S. team. Those SEALs 136-84 right now with 20 seconds to play. Awesome, awesome game. Really fun to watch. Very good. Good job to all of our players.
Yeah, so the North Americans are going to take it, Vaughn. 143 on the board right now. They're still putting points up. So the Europeans took game one. Now the Americans take a game, or take two games, actually. So, yeah, it's been interesting so far.
What a great thing. Thank you, everyone, to the stream. What a great time.
Yeah, had a blast.
Thanks for being here, man.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Victory.
All right, guys.
Look at that Optic game.
Yeah, Optic Gaming over here going bananas.
All right, guys, we're going to play some Domination next. We're going to go Domination on Aftermath.
Good morning, North Americans. This is your wake-up call. I think you've just got over your jet lag and redressed that balance. It's a great win from the North Americans there, right?
Yeah, absolutely. They pulled it out in the end. Really rough first game there, but they pulled it all out and ended up coming out with victory.
Tell us about some of those big attachments and weapons that we saw being put to good use there.
Yeah, man, we're seeing all sorts of really interesting stuff in play. So it's always awesome to see players use the Creator class, Pit 10, and Wildcard system, combining this content in interesting ways to work together to hold those objectives. I saw that laser sight come out. That's how you increase your hip fire accuracy. And like we were saying, there are no perks that modify your weapons. You have to take something. So the laser sight gets visualized. When that guy's spraying you down from the hip, you understand why, because you can see that laser sight.
All right, it's North America 1. It is Europe 1. I think that calls for a decider, right? I think we're going to Domination on Aftermath, yeah?
Oh, okay. Yeah, so we're going to hit a Domination on Aftermath. So here we go. We finally get to see the map.
Yeah.
And why don't you talk about it?
Oh, man. So listen, Aftermath is drone attack in 2025, right? Lots of destruction. This is a great Domination map. These points are spaced really well. This is going to be a pretty intense scene. These guys have not played Domination today. You know they're jonesing to play some Domination.
Yeah.
All right, the big decider. It all hangs on this. Let's get this gameplay on.
All right, we're going.
So here we go again.
We're going.
No tiebreaker. Kind of. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, it's tiebreaker.
Come to.
I love to lose track of how many rounds have been played. But anyway, I always get on track before the game ends. And here we go. We got perks.
Now look at this. Optic Ray right here has ployed two perk greed cards in this class. He's running hardline and lightweight perk one greed. He's running dead silence and extreme conditioning. That's perk three greed. That is a pretty interesting class combination for domination.
Yeah, that's absolutely amazing, actually. He's got... That might be the first time I've seen somebody stack that many perks using this system, you know, and it's what, five perks total here?
Five perks total here, but he's had to make some significant trade-offs, Astro, because he's not running any equipment. Look down there on the lower right of his HUD.
Absolutely.
And looks like he's not even running a secondary weapon right now. So you can make these trade-offs in Black Ops multiplayer.
Yeah, and look at him. He's got a... I'm absolutely loving this by Ray from Optic Gaming. He's got hardline and lightweight in perk one, hardwired, dead silence, extreme conditioning. I'm going to spit it all out for the fans out here. He's got the laser sight attachment on his weapon, and that's about it, right?
Well, he seems to be working for him.
Yeah.
He's just picking up this Hunter Killer drone. He throws that thing out. Now it's seeking a target right now. You can see it on the map.
There it goes.
Put the thing down, plus 15. Absolutely awesome right there. And you can defend against that. If you have the flak jacket, you can defend against that.
Looks like one of the enemies was going straight for the B flag, and that Hunter Killer drone seeked out that enemy and just took him out before you get on the flag. So that's a pretty awesome score streak right there.
A lot of fun play here.
And it's low level, so pretty cool deal there, as the Americans and North Americans are in the lead, 28-17, 4 minutes and 30 seconds left to go.
That
now
looks like the SEALs team has been locking down B and C for quite some time now and making them hold A and push out. You can tell right here by looking at the top of your screen, you'll see the SEAL BC right under there and A under the opposition.
Absolutely. So now we're on board with Merc, and Merc is running into a ton of players, and he's sitting over here near us, and we can just hear him just go, oh, a little overwhelmed. There's so many European players right there.
Oh,
Merc
out with the ballista iron sights. The snipers, you guys owe me for this gun. I'm telling you right now.
Let's actually stay on board with Merc. Let's see if he's going to run into anybody here. Looks like he is.
No good for hair. No, taken out by Swanee big time.
The ballista is a very precision weapon, right? It's a bolt action, and it's a sniper. But when you have the iron sights on, you really have to kind of watch yourself. It looks like Merc is learning from that now, and he's going to try and do that.
I give Merc credit for that, but he's not having much luck so far.
Yeah, and now it looks like he spots another player. He takes a shot there. Now, you actually see the trails on the sniper rifles as well. What's up with that? Why don't you talk a little bit about that? Because that's going to be – there's so many snipers out there, and now you see a bullet trail. That's the most badass thing, man. Why don't you tell us a little bit about it?
Yeah, it's something that our combat designer, Tony Flamer, had in store. He showed it to us one day. We thought it was absolutely excellent. Just an interesting way to see where those snipers are shooting from.
Yeah, it's really cool. You're able to see, you know, especially it kind of raises your skin or the hair on your skin a little bit, too, when you see a shot come flying by your face.
Yeah.
So I love that. And why don't we actually listen into the players again? Because look at the score now. It looks like the Europeans are in control of two flags, and they just took the lead over the North Americans, 55-53. Let's listen in to the Europeans.
A hostile hunter.
Got him.
One is on the right side.
Yeah, one more.
Through the top, one comes
straight to the middle. One of you's got to be.
There's a rounding house,
One more, right one shot.
Well, one's going to be, he's toppy. Nice. Did you get him? One is at the tunnel.
One guy, one on here.
Losing. Where is an alpha? Push your seat. Come on in, everyone. One guy, one behind you. Got him. Yeah, nice.
Locked down. Now, that is some intense action right there. Looks like the North Americans were able to kind of flip the spawns a little bit, but the Europeans picked that up immediately and were able to go right back and grab C. So they still have the lead here, Von, 85-71 now. And Gunshi is sitting on those score streaks again. He kind of likes to just play with the gun.
Matt, when you got a guy that's this much of a slayer, he's too busy to pull out those score streaks right now. He'll find them when he needs them.
Absolutely. Gunchy, one of the best slayers in the world in Call of Duty competitive. And you see that right there. What a shot that was with the target finder. It was just amazing what he just did. There he spots another one. He got that nice headshot. Somebody was barely sticking out over a ledge, and he managed to pick him off. 55 seconds left to go now. The Europeans still in the lead. They're up by 21 now, and Gunchy is on a tear, Vaughn.
Yeah, this game is not completely over, though. I bet we're playing some round-based domination right now, so we're going to find out.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So why don't we talk about that?
Let's find out if we set it up that way in 35 seconds.
Cool. Yeah, we'll know in 35 seconds. But B and C still in control for the Europeans. They're on the Mercs faction. Again, like we said, we'll take a look at this overhead map. Gunchy's about to run into a couple players here from North America.
Oh, beautiful.
And why don't we go ahead and swap it up a little bit. Let's see. Nice. Over here for the European side. He just catches a stun grenade right there. 15 seconds left to go. He gets smoked. What's he rocking? He's got the Scorpion. And 7 seconds left now, so the Europeans are going to take this one. And there's your score. Now we're able to even go out and play another round if we'd like. We can do round-based domination.
Absolutely. Round-based domination is a feature of the game, so it'll flip sides. And that's something that competitive players really like to play, and we're going to make sure that they can do that when the game comes out on November 13th.
Yeah, and that's awesome. So a lot of true competitive game modes that the community has played, we're actually using some of those features here in Black Ops 2.
Absolutely.
And it looks like that's going to be it.
David.
Fantastic work, everybody. What an amazing evening, right?
Incredible. Some amazing gameplay and great day of all this. You can see them properly as well, right?
Now, we got the guys here. You guys want to say a few words before we wrap up? Because we are at the end of our hour.
I want one time. Thank you so much for joining us live, the debut of Call of Duty Black Ops 2. Well, that was awesome.
Yeah, just want to say thank you, hey, to all you guys at Microsoft and Twitch and Turtle Beach, and most importantly, thank you guys, the fans. Without you guys, we wouldn't be able to do this. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Well, without you guys, we wouldn't be able to do this either. Now, I got to tell you, if you're on Twitter, Black Ops 2 MP, the Black Ops number 2 MP, and you can participate in the conversation, because later on this week, we're here for the rest of the week.
Yes, we are live streaming every night for the rest of this week, Thursday, Friday, Saturday. Tomorrow night is community night, right? So that is the night where we really, really want all your comments, questions on Twitter, so keep them coming into that hashtag. It's 5 p.m. UK, 6 p.m. German time. I'll let you work out the rest.
That's 9 a.m. Pacific, 12 noon Eastern, and well, you got the web to figure the rest out.
Such a good team. And you can see it on Xbox.com in Europe. You can see it on the Black Ops Facebook page. You can see it on twitch.tv/Treyarch. And you can see it at CallofDuty.com as well.
We actually had a question about, this one was brought right into the Xbox 360 console. In about 15 minutes, it's going to be available on demand.
So if you've missed this.
Yes.
Then you'll still be able to see it.
If you want to see more of Graham and I, then just tune in and you'll see all the great gameplay.
And who would?
There you go. All right, we're going to wrap it up here. My name's Larry here at Xbox Live's Major Nelson here in Germany at Gamescom. On behalf of AC Bongos, I want to thank you. Thank everybody here in the audience. And we will see you guys tomorrow. Good night, everybody.
Good night.